The views and opinions expressed in the following program are those of the hosts and guests, and not necessarily those of the staff or management of Worldwide Digital Broadcasting Corporation.
Knowledge is power, and this is Powerful Stuff. Wellness Education Cannabis Advocates of Nevada present the We Can 702 Nevada Cannabis News Hour with the We Can Radio Team. For the next 60 minutes, we'll take an in-depth look at the cannabis reform revolution sweeping the nation. Now, let's fire up the News Hour. Here is the We Can Radio Team.
Good afternoon and welcome to the Nevada Cannabis News Hour. I'm your host, Mike McAuliffe, and with me, as always, in the studio is my co-host and good friend, Perry Heitschu. How are you doing today, Perry?
Very well. How about yourself, sir?
Outstanding. Fantastic. You know, here we are, you know, on a fifth day in the Trump administration, and we're all here. There has been no nuclear fireball yet, so I'm optimistic for the future, at least till the end of the day.
Call him what you want, but you can't call him lazy. He's been busy.
He has. You know, at first, actually, I thought that, oh boy, he's not going to pay any attention, because the first thing I heard before the inauguration was that he was not planning on doing any work over the weekend, that after the inauguration on Friday, he was going to do the parties, and then Monday morning start at work. But he did actually start with executive orders
right away,
and
bucking the trend of most president-elects who are very happy to get off the campaign trail and take it easy for a little while after they roll into the new transitional phase.
Well, I do understand that after running for office for 2 years and crisscrossing the country countless times, that people would want a little break, but you know, you would think that break would be between November and January.
No,
and
well, he was busy doing his victory tour between November and January, so he actually never stopped moving.
Yes, he was. So we see that the Senate is moving forward with most of his nominations for his cabinet at this point, and as we've discussed on the program before, we do have some very negative people negatively disposed towards cannabis who are coming into this. And,
but on the plus side, maybe his FDA pick is supposedly pro marijuana, so we'll see how
that goes. Outstanding.
That's like a chink in that armor, I suppose.
So we will see. You know, I am curious, you know, talking about the president here for a sec, I know that one of the important things, campaign promises he made was initially that, you know, on day one, he's going to get in there and he's going to stop this DACA, which is the Dreamer Act for the kids of immigrants to stay here and all this sort of stuff. And he said, well, we're going to get rid of that right away.
Now he's backed off on that,
you know.
Well, that's the right thing. That's the right thing to do. You know what I mean?
I agree.
I think he kind of wised up a little bit, and he's realized, like, look, you know, we want to retain the best and brightest of these kids who have gone through our educational system. Why would we spend this entire 20 years to educate these people only to throw them right away?
That's,
you know, that doesn't make any sense. If anything, we want to stoke that fire of loyalty and allow them to stay here and not return to their homeland and take those talents elsewhere, which is what we've had, an exodus of intelligent folk in this country. We don't want to continue that trend.
Very true.
And besides that, the people who we want gone, you know, in my opinion, there's a lot of Hispanics who should be backing his play because they flee Mexico because of the fears they have over living there. Yeah, of course. Yeah,
sure.
we can say that for, you know, a lot of places in the northern and southern hemisphere. Mm-hmm. But and then they come here and they demand these open borders so that all of the bad people are allowed to flow across the border in order to make our country as bad as theirs. We need to stop, you know, the people. It's like you were saying, you know, if you've committed serious felonies or anything like that and you're an illegal immigrant, you got to go.
That's fine.
You know what I mean? And it's going to be hard to sway most Americans away from that.
Position. And you know, I'm very progressive, but I agree with that as well.
You know, but that number doesn't come up to 11 million. That number comes out to a minute fraction of that 11 million, but if we can solve a disproportionate amount of the criminal problems by targeting a very small subsegment of that society, then why shouldn't we go at it with a scalpel instead of a broadsword?
I agree, and I do believe that the kids of these immigrants, illegal or otherwise, who grew up here, they're American kids. They're American culture, American education, as you talked about, and we really shouldn't hold it against them. But where I wanted to go with that is, you know, as someone who is conservative, as someone who is on the Republican side of it, how do you think it bodes for the new president that you know, one of his primary campaign promises on day one or day two in office, he's already backing off this. Not whether it's right or wrong or he's evolving or whatever, but how do you think this will affect his base?
His base is going to be behind him no matter what.
So people, he really could shoot somebody on Fifth Avenue and not lose any support.
I think he could absolutely shoot someone on Fifth Avenue and not lose support.
I'm going to stay away from Manhattan for a while.
No doubt about it. Well, he carries concealed, according to him.
Really?
He said that numerous times. He wants to push a national concealed carry. He carries his own. Wow. He doesn't rely on people to protect him. He can protect himself, he says. So
we can save all that money by getting rid of the Secret Service. Who knew?
Well, you know, that was one of his things. He's just like, you know, he practices what he preaches, basically. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You know, Clinton, Obama, all these people say, you know, people shouldn't have guns, but yet all their protectors have guns. Well, he openly carries a gun and advocates for gun rights.
Wow, I've never seen anything where he actually carries firearms, but I'm not doubting.
It was kind of in passing during one of the debates because like concealed carry was such a back burner issue during this campaign that people weren't really focused on it. Like I'm surprised it didn't get more attention during the Republican primary, to tell you the truth. It didn't come out a little bit more. But still, like back to the Dreamers and things like that, I think that most Republicans, even the real conservative ones, are aware of constitutional law and the fact that people who were born here in the United States are American citizens, and that's the end of the story. You can't retroactively take someone's I've never heard of anyone taking someone's citizenship away retroactively. Now, if you want to put a policy forward that says that, you know, if you're a foreign national that flies to the United States to have a kid purposely and flies away, you know, I'm aware that the mainland Chinese do this a lot, and you know, certain Latinos and things like that, and a lot of people do that to take advantage of our system. If you want to do that later, fine, then let's pass that law. But don't talk about retroactively taking away people's American citizenship. You just can't do that in order to satisfy your political pandering. Mm-hmm. You just can't do it. I mean, it'll never hold up. Right. I can't imagine that a conservative court, even if they owed Trump favors, would do that.
And in fact, I'm reading a lot of articles online, various sources, and some of the sources like Politico say that Republicans in the Congress and Senate are saying we're going to get as much mileage out of him as we can, and then we're going to dump him because things that he's doing that lawsuits are already being filed about the unconstitutionality of, you know, his mixing his business and the emoluments clause and
there's
foreign
nothing,
money and all
there's
that sort of
nothing
stuff.
Preventing him from the president of the United States is exempt. Once again, he's exempt from conflicts of interest. He doesn't have he never had to do
really,
any
I
of
thought
these
we were
things.
A nation of laws and,
sure, we're
and
a
not
nation
a nation of men, and so therefore in anyone, even the president is accountable. I mean, we only have to look back to Richard Nixon or Bill Clinton's impeachment to see that.
True, but I don't believe that being a successful capitalist is grounds for removal from a public office.
I agree.
And I don't really like the idea that he should be forced to sell 100% of his business assets because that creates a whole new set of problems.
But he wasn't drafted to be the president. He chose to seek this office knowing full well what the constraints and limits were before.
There are
he
no
even
constraints
announced.
And limits. These are fabricated constraints by the left that want him to separate himself from these businesses for their own for their own purposes. And I think that he should not take the stance that George Bush Sr. took. Mm-hmm. When he got elected, he, you know, read my lips, George 41.
Right.
Read my lips, no new taxes. And then he reached out to the Democrats across the aisle and got that 2-for-1 spending. You know, he got more cuts than taxes raised. He cut
it
that deal.
It was a good deal, and but they forced him to break that pledge, which cost him 4 years later.
Well, because they turned around and burned him. They said, oh, well, George, you screwed us. So learning from that lesson, I wouldn't trust him. If I was Trump, I would bend over exactly 0% because even if he did everything that they said, sold all of his businesses and did everything he wanted, they would still throw him under the bus. So there's no reason to compromise at all, period.
Yeah.
Because they've done everything they can. You know, what about those dozen women who were accusing him of sexual assault who magically evaporated? What happened to them?
Right.
Should they be prosecuted for false accusations of rape?
I understand one woman is trying to go forward with the suit, represented by Gloria Allred, the California attorney, and they're looking to crowdfund it to pay for it.
Super duper. You know, if all the 3 million women protesters yesterday would have donated $150, they could privately fund Planned Parenthood instead of spending all that white privilege money to fly to Washington, D.C. for one day for a damn pro. Well, actually, it wasn't that. They actually already probably had those tickets purchased to see Hillary's inauguration very arrogantly all those months ago.
Yeah,
so that's why they were there.
So then let me ask you, as someone who is a Trump supporter, how do you see the news that's been coming so far? What do you think he's going to do regarding cannabis?
Nothing.
Okay.
Nothing at all.
Medical, I agree. And he's already come out and said that he's in favor of that.
I think he's going to completely, once again, my stance on that hasn't changed since the day he got nominated. I was never really afraid of him. I'm afraid of the people he's unintentionally putting around himself.
Yeah.
You see, we're hyper-focused as this special interest group, as they call us, on the issues that are important to us.
Of course.
Which is the people that he's nominating within his cabinet that may or may not have a direct effect on the industry that we've helped to build. He's way over here. He's over here, national security and this, that, and the other. He's not worried about people smoking grass. He'll get to that when he gets to that, if he gets to that. What may happen is the people that he puts in power may make moves independently against the industry, which will force him to react to it.
Right.
Most likely being in support because he's fiercely loyal. But then again, he doesn't really answer to anyone, and he's apt to do whatever the hell he wants to do at any given moment.
So
we don't know.
Given that, looking at statistics and studies, historically, more Americans have admitted to trying and using marijuana than actually voted for Donald Trump for president.
Sure,
as someone who is a populist president, do you think then that he's going to look at those kind of numbers and say, that's, I don't want to poke that bear.
Oh, I would certainly hope so. You could only hope that he would be able to utilize the media as he's played them like a fiddle this whole time.
Yes,
to play that narrative also and play to whatever base he chooses to coddle to on a daily basis.
Mm-hmm.
He could flip the entire marijuana industry over to his side by saying, you know what? We're going to allow the banking. We're going to deregulate.
Mm.
And they'd be like, oh my God, he could do more for marijuana than Obama did in 8 years in 5 seconds with the stroke of his pen if he chose to. And he can. Will he? Probably not.
I've got to say that I agree with part of what you just said there in that...
Not for the prisoners, because he's not going to do shit about the prisoners.
No, once they're already in. And I do commend President Obama for the commutations and the pardons that he made. He became the president who is... conducted the largest number of pardons in American history. And, I think that is really a good thing because most of those people, non-violent drug offenders that got commuted, didn't deserve to be in jail in the first place. So I do think that was a good
thing. And it costs the taxpayers an outrageous amount of money to keep these people in prison.
Last I saw
it
was $43,000 a year.
If we're looking to cut the fat, that's a good way to do it,
It
sure
is.
If these people get themselves in trouble later in life, then, you can't protect them from themselves.
But at the same time, I was ultimately disappointed. I liked what candidate Obama had to say in 2008 in regards to medical marijuana and cannabis in general. And I supported him through that election. And I supported him after we got in front of him at a town hall meeting. And he said, I've stopped the prosecutions. And he came in and raided us. And I supported him after I got indicted and jammed up by the federal government, and I supported him saying, oh, he can't do anything in his first term, first black president, second term. And as we were ticking down the time, I said, okay, he's going to stick it to him. He'll do it in the last week. He'll do it. And he
wasn't
didn't.
On his radar.
A guy who was a member of the Chum gang, and if he had had an arrest record from his prodigious marijuana smoking
never
over the years.
Never would have been able to
run. Never made senator, let alone president. And for him to so callously just dismiss, the large number of Americans who know that cannabis is a safe and effective means of medical therapy, of just relaxation, of being able to sleep without all sorts of pharmaceuticals. I think he did that sector of America a tremendous disservice by not acting before he left. So count me among the disappointed there.
Well, no doubt. When we were interviewing Tommy Chong, you know, he was prosecuted by the Bush administration.
Indeed.
When I saw his stand-up comedy, he was very aggressively anti-McCain, anti-Republican. Mm-hmm. He blamed the Republican administration mm-hmm. for the predicament that he had been in and things like that. And I didn't have the heart to tell him, Tommy, you know, it's all the same. It would have been just the same under Obama or anyone else. You know,
sure. Reagan declared the war on drugs, but Bill Clinton really ratcheted it up.
Well, sure. You know, Hillary Clinton was the one who labeled black men super predators and
indeed.
Things like that.
That's
and,
true.
You know, got a pass.
That's true.
And, you know, all this kind of crap and, you know, promised criminal justice reform. But really, she was the one who helped her husband push that the three strikes law and things like that. You know, mm-hmm. there's a lot of unintended consequences that came from those the war on crime, as they put it back in the 90s. Mm-hmm. We're still struggling with the consequences.
But, you know,
that.
I want to touch quickly on something that we were talking about, Trump being a populist president, and, you know, we're going with the will of the people.
Oh, yeah, that's right. What I was going to say in regards to that is I'm kind of afraid of that because Trump has admittedly he never smoked pot. He doesn't drink, you know, so it's going to be hard for him to when we go, hey, man. You know, we need you to understand
he sees
this.
Substance use as a moral failing, essentially, or a personal weakness, if not moral failing.
But he also has Trump-branded wines. I remember he had Trump-branded vodka for a while in the liquor stores in the shape of his Trump Tower. Mm-hmm. So, you know, if he sees money in it, whether he's morally against it or not, or doesn't use it, he'll jump at the opportunity. And
not dissimilar, I guess, from the Mormons in Utah and Nevada who were not drinking or gambling but became bankers and financed the casino industry here in Las Vegas.
Oh, yeah, and railroaded Howard Hughes and do a bunch of crazy stuff. You know, I don't want to get into what, you know, the Mormons and all that. They're crooked as the rest.
Being, they were not personally using these various vices, let's say, but they saw the money in it, and they got behind it.
Of course. And, you know, like I said, Trump's a capitalist. And I'm hoping that at pure, whatever he is, he's about making money. Mm-hmm. And when he I'm hoping that if he sees the numbers, the number jobs being created and, you know, all the tax revenue and things like that, it's just going to be hard. It's going to be hard to ignore when he's trying to, you know, if he's all about big league jobs, mm-hmm. then, you know, how are you going to shut down the growers and shut down they're making $100,000 a year?
Just before I came to the studio, I came across a graphic from Greenwich Daily, which I will bring in for the next show or see if I can get it on here, which shows that so far across America, almost 200,000 jobs have been created in the legal cannabis industry. And this is just a fraction of where the industry is going to be in years. And I had I had another story around here somewhere, but maybe not, which is Troy Dayton, the principal of ArcView, who is saying that within 4 years now, by 2021, they expect the cannabis market to triple in size, to go from a current $6.7 billion up to about $21 billion annually. And
is this it?
ArcView, yeah. Okay, here we go. Thanks. He says that, this is actually slightly different but related. The legal market should grow from $6.9 billion, to $21.6 billion by 2021. Now, granted, this is not just all of a sudden everybody's starting to smoke weed. This is a shifting of the money from the black market into a legal regulated market. So you're taking the money away from people who don't pay taxes, people who are argued by law enforcement, funneling the money to drug trafficking.
We're only going
to
be
putting it in public coffers.
We're only going to be able to put it in public coffers if it becomes affordable, more affordable than the black market. And my favorite Democrat governor, Brian Sandoval, is talking, mm-hmm. We'll never defeat the black market.
Right. They're talking about putting a new tax.
They're going another 10% tax. Yes. So the recreational taxes in Nevada will be 25%, and they have the right to raise it all the way to 30% during legislature if they choose
they
to, which I assume they will, of course. And
if they're going to come through that in the legislature and increase the tax, you know, Vegas is a betting town. Who's going to propose that increase? A Democrat or a Republican?
They're both the same party in Nevada.
Oh, well.
I mean, the Republicans passed the Republican House with a Republican governor passed the largest tax increase in state history without a fight last year.
Yeah.
You know, and now I'm just terrified to see what the Democrats can do to this once safe tax haven. Mm-hmm. At this point, you know, I don't really like the way the state is going with that. It's been going the wrong way in the tax revenue scheme for a long time. We're taxing the wrong people. You know, they voted down the mining tax, which hasn't been changed in over 100 years. But yet
because
ready
it's
to,
in the state constitution.
That's a bunch of horseshit. You can change it.
Well, it is. And you can, but you still need a supermajority to do so.
Well, you need a supermajority.
And I'm not defending. No, I'm not defending.
You need a supermajority to do a lot of things. But what they do is they have wonderful lobbyists.
Yes.
You know, they throw a lot of money around up there, and that's the reason why they've been able to do what they do.
Just like the pharmaceutical industry, when you were up there in 2013 pushing for the law that and spending your own money out of pocket to pass the law that eventually made all these dispensaries possible. And so there are a lot of lobbyists, and I see that happening. You know, we've covered some stories on the show here about the opioid crisis and the fact that cannabis is a gateway out of opioid addiction. And the governor has been very much on point with this. He has his wife who is going out and championing this cause, and they came up with new legislation last session, and they're going to do so here as well. So I think though that focus is really in the wrong place as far as it comes to cannabis. They're still not realizing the benefits of cannabis here. But let me get back to this story, which is that North Americans now are spending nearly as much on weed as they do on wine. And this comes from Philip Smith at alternet.org and posted just yesterday. And in an executive summary, ArcView Marijuana Research pegs the size of the North American marijuana market, legal and illegal, at $53.3 billion. Which puts it roughly even with the market in wine. According to the Statistica, U.S. retail wine sits at $55.8 billion. So it really is very close.
It's neck and neck.
Yeah, it is neck and neck. And although it hasn't taken over, it's pretty damn close at this point. And the stat that I had mentioned a little while ago, that the legal market is going to more than triple in size by 2021. To me, any business person that you would go to, any capitalist, anyone who understands market economics, if you go ahead and say, I've got a business here that's going to triple in 4 years, they would all be completely on board with something.
Well, sure, but the problem is you can't put money in the bank here, and you know, there's a whole bunch of other stuff that we need to chew through before we can attract a lot of these high net worth individuals that are willing to really put their their money where their
and
mouth is.
And let's talk about that a little bit. We have a guest on the line here, and this would be Adam Bierman. Do we need our headsets here?
Can you hear him?
No? Can we hear him? Adam, are you there?
I'm here. Hi, guys.
Outstanding. How are you doing today, Adam?
I'm good, and always a pleasure to talk to you.
Absolutely. So I'm here with my co-host Perry Haichu, also of WeCan, and you know, we've been talking a little bit about the modern America now in the Trump administration, and I think that with your travels across the country, you might have some insights about that. But Adam Bierman, you are the founder of MedMen, based in Southern California, but reaching nationally. I know that we've spoken about this in the past, and you've told me that you're something of an empire builder. So could you explain to our audience first what MedMen is, what you guys are doing?
Well, I don't know if I ever used those words. I hope I didn't. That sounds obnoxious if I ever said
no,
that.
No, it's not. It's not obnoxious at all. It's ambitious, you know, and that's
I'll
a good thing.
Ambitious. I'll take ambitious. Thank you, Michael. MedMen is two pieces. We have a management company, and we operate licenses on behalf of license holders across North America, cultivation, production, and retail. And we are a capital firm. And right now, that means a private equity fund, and that private equity fund invests directly into the space, real estate, and licenses to cultivate, manufacture, and retail legal cannabis.
Wow. How many states are you in at this point?
So we are in 3 states and Canada. So we have 4 territories where we currently have exposure: California, Nevada, New York, and then Toronto, Canada.
Great. Well, you know, let's talk about those a little bit. Obviously, you got your start in California, which is a huge market, arguably the largest in the country. And we see that California has just legalized at this point. So how do you, that's your backyard, essentially. Where do you see things going in the next year or so? As I would imagine, your medical facilities are all going to be transitioning to the retail market.
Yeah, I mean that is the anticipation. I think what's really exciting about California is just, you know, a regulatory system, mm-hmm. right? I mean, just that in and of itself is exciting to me, and I don't care, you know, that much if it, you know, hurts business, makes business harder, makes business easier, you know, creates more competition, less competition. I think first and foremost what's important is just something firm. You know, an actual license. That would be nice. Mm-hmm. Keep in mind, California is this outlier. You mentioned it, and I'll go further. California is the largest marijuana market in the world. Yet, you know, we're sitting here in the United States among states like Nevada that have figured out how to get it right and issue state licenses so that there's a clear line between people that are doing things lawfully and not. And we're still sitting here as the state that legalized medical marijuana over 25 years ago, and we haven't been able to figure out how to issue state licenses.
So you're still doing everything county by county then?
Yeah, everything is municipality mm-hmm. by municipality, right? And we're fortunate that, we have exposure into cities that have actual licenses. But that being said, we don't have a state license to match it. So, you know, the first thing that's going to happen here in 2018 is the state will have a system by which it will issue these licenses, these state licenses, not unlike those that have been issued at the state of Nevada. And that is an amazing start. And then you ask, you know, what comes from there? You know, a lot of it's speculative because the rules haven't been written yet. But, you know, the one thing that we're pretty certain about is that those people that are compliant and have licensure at a local level will be able to match it with a state license and start from there. And if you look at a place like LA, which, you know, as a city is arguably the, you know, biggest marijuana market in the world from a municipal perspective, you know, you probably have 1,000 illegal operators right now. Mm-hmm. And so by issuing real licenses at the state level and those matching a city level, real clear delineation between who's legit and who's not. And, you know, those people that are paying their taxes and doing things lawfully, which normally costs more, which means they're at a competitive disadvantage, now get to catch up because the other people, get shut down in the process. So it's a very exciting time with a lot of moving parts over here in California.
When you're talking about Los Angeles, are you specifically talking about the pre-ICO licenses versus the post-ICO licensing or the Prop D? Or is that kind of where you're going with that? There's only 100 and something real pre-ICO licenses, and they're attempting to exert their authority over the idea that they were here first. Is that basically the gist of it?
That's a general gist. You know, the detail on that is there's the pre-ICO, and then there was Prop D,
right?
And now there's, you know, the new ballot initiative this March that we hope very much, you know, the voters will get behind and pass. But, you know, it's been an iterative process here, and so now what we really are going off of is what we call like the red BTRCs, which are these business tax certificates, and the city actually issued 170 some odd certificates last month. And the way the Office of Finance is going about this now is to say those are the only marijuana businesses they're recognizing. Those are the only marijuana businesses that are able to actually pay taxes now in the city. It's a beginning of a way to start kind of, you know, again, delineating between who's acting lawfully and not. And the first place they're starting, which is great, is to say if you don't have one of these business tax permits, you can't pay taxes, which means you're unlawfully operating. And there were only 170 some odd that were issued. So those 170 were, you know, a product of what you just mentioned, pre-ICO, Prop D, and mm-hmm. where we are today and who the city is kind of deeming as lawful.
So okay. Let me ask, I saw an article in Marijuana Business Daily a couple of weeks ago, and you were interviewed in it, among others, and the article was about where the pot capital of the United States is going to be. And of course, right now, Denver has been claiming that title. And in the article, you had said that that L.A., the California, is the natural pot capital because, as you say, it's the largest marijuana market in the world, and you know, there's good cause for that. But at the same time, I see that in Massachusetts now, they're planning on opening later this year a 1 million square foot facility, and that they're saying, hey, not wait for us, because we're, you know, we're in a really densely populated part of the country, and so we're going to be really rolling out here. And I know your company's not in Massachusetts. You are in New York. We'll get to that in a minute. But speaking of these large facilities, you're constructing a place up in outside of Fernley, I understand, and you've already broken ground, and that you're moving into the Nevada market with that. Can you tell us a little bit more about it?
About what I feel about the Nevada market, or comparing
about where you think do you think there is going to be an established geolocation that is going to be the leader of the market, or the nature, the way that the marijuana legislation and just the changing attitude towards it means that it's going to be more decentralized, and there's no leader in that area going to be, that you're going to find all the states coming up with revenue generating options.
Yeah, I mean, I think, look, I mean, you mentioned Colorado, and the only thing that comes to my mind now is snowboarding and skiing. Mm. And so, you know, what is the snow capital of the country? I don't know, right?
Yeah, okay.
It all depends on what you want to
exactly.
do. So, you know, I think that, you know, if you want to talk about the state that generates the most revenue in total dollars when it comes to marijuana sales, there's nobody that's going to argue that any state is going to be larger than California,
yeah.
right? California makes over half.
From the soothing sounds of a water wall to the warmth wood interior.
So then let me ask you then, what about your facility in Nevada? I know that you had come to Nevada several years ago and had put in a number of different licenses, applications, and some of them were granted. So how are your development plans going here?
Great. We're actually in Washoe County, outside mm-hmm. of Reno. We're building a cultivation and manufacturing facility. We're building a high-tech Dutch greenhouse on the cultivation side. We believe it's the first time that technology has been deployed for legal marijuana in the U.S. At least mm-hmm. we've discovered. Nobody's come and said, "Yeah, come look at this." We'd love to see it if it exists. We don't think it yet exists, so we're very excited about that. You know, it's high tech, it's efficient. You know, it's big. It's utilizing big agricultural best practices. We believe that it will be a model for the industry, and it happens to be in Washoe County. So, I mean, it's pretty exciting. A lot of support there locally, and we believe in the Nevada market very much. We believe that the Nevada market's an important market, and, you know, the way that we're looking at it right now is to be a large manufacturer in the state, manufacturing products that get distributed to the retail locations throughout the state. And look, with 40 million plus tourists, I don't need to tell you guys,
sure.
You know, what type of opportunity Nevada is on the adult use side of things. But we believe in it very much. We're deploying a lot of capital in the state, and we're very excited about the project. It goes live sometime April, May.
Are you completely vertically integrated? Do you have a dispensary license as well?
No retail. So
no retail yet. So you're going to be supplying, which with, as you're saying, the 40 million people that come here into Clark County every year are going to be a substantial consumer market as this thing gets rolling. So at this point, you're looking to be a wholesale supplier into that market.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Switch over a little bit here. Things are changing around in New York, and you had mentioned them a little bit earlier in the conversation. And apparently, the governor, Andrew Cuomo, has said last Wednesday that New York should stop penalizing people over small amounts of cannabis. And I'm reading from an article here from Green Rush Daily, and he says he believes the laws should reflect the dramatic shift in public opinion, the one across the nation illustrated by 29 states with legal medical marijuana laws. And, you know, I've been, being born in New York and raised in New York City, I follow what's going on there. And Governor Cuomo has not really been a friend to the medical marijuana industry as it's been trying to develop in New York. So I see this as a pretty big shift for him. He did try to do some decriminalization back in 2012, but it seems now that the time is right for this. I know you've been in discussions with people in New York, as you've said, and are moving there. Moving forward there. What are your reads on what's going on there? Because New York, I think, is such an important state when you look at the Eastern core of the country and the attitudes.
Yeah, we believe very much it's an important state and market, and worked very hard to position ourselves there. I think I would say in regards to the governor's comments, I think that they are, you know, more than welcomed, right, by myself, by the company, and by the whole industry. I think that what's important to remember, and you mentioned Trump at the beginning of the call, mm-hmm. I think what's important to remember is, you know, this movement towards legalization and the end of prohibition, you know, isn't something that is started or stopped by a single individual, whether that is somebody, you know, in the executive branch or in the White House, whether that's a governor or, you know, whether that's a local official, right? This is a movement that has been gaining momentum for 20 plus years, and a lot of people have poured their lives into it, as I know you have, Michael.
Sure.
And so I think that the inevitability, based on the momentum amongst, you know, the general public, is that lawmakers, regulators, government officials, you know, ultimately will have no choice and will not be able to ignore, you know, the combination, you know, that currently exists between the medical efficacy that's proven out more and more every day, you know, the benefit to communities that gets proven out more and more every day, you know, the fiscal windfalls that get proven out more and more every day. And I think what we're seeing politically, and, you know, we mentioned Colorado, we'll mention it again, is, you know, one of the biggest opponents of adult use in Colorado was their sitting governor, who took out ads against. But once the people voted it in, you know, what did he do? You know, he went and made public statements saying, I just, you know, I'm a servant to the will of the people. Mm-hmm. Let's go implement this, and let's do so as responsibly as possible. And look at how well that experiment has gone in that one particular small state. So,
indeed. And recently he has made more comments saying that he's reconsidering his earlier position and the sky hasn't fallen and that it wasn't nearly as bad as he thought it would be. And not bad at all, actually.
So, yeah, I mean, to your point, right? The governor's office in New York was not a huge fan of this, you know, effort. This effort was an effort that took, you know, not just one person's time and energy, but many, many people's time and energy, and then had a couple champions, and then one individual champion, a state senator that I believe you know. Mm-hmm. And even once it got passed, it was extremely restrictive, and that was in large part due to the, you know, lack of excitement, if you will, as a nice way to put it, by the governor's office. But what happens inevitably, right? Businesses get off the ground, patients start getting access, doctors get smarter and more informed. There's, you know, a larger demand to access this lawfully. There's a social justice argument that comes more to the forefront, which is, I think, what you were referencing in the quote. Mm-hmm. You know, and this is where it goes. And so, you know, I think it's great to hear quotes like that, and it makes sense. And I believe that as you see all these states start to open up, even if their programs are highly restrictive at the outset, or even in Massachusetts, I mean, look at the negative ads in Massachusetts and who paid for those ads. You know, at the end of the day, there is a betterment of the community and the will of the people, and overwhelmingly, we are trending towards, you know, legalizing adult use and ending prohibition.
And indeed, and we're seeing this all over because I see that a new bill has been filed in Missouri to allow access to medical marijuana throughout the state, and it was introduced by Republican Jim Neely. So you're seeing this happening in the Bible Belt. Of course, in November, Arkansas became the first Bible Belt state to legalize medical marijuana, and so it is moving forward. And I've got to wonder, though, part of from our previous discussions, I know a lot of what you do is going out there and meeting people and finding investors and helping guide them along when they want to get in this industry. And surely for you, one of the biggest challenges has to be the federal banking laws, which prevent banks from servicing any of these businesses. And now that you're in several states, and we'll leave Canada out of it for the moment, but that you're in these states, how is this affecting your ability to grow and to get these businesses operational and compliant?
Well, I think talking about banking and being in Las Vegas, you know, you guys actually have the, you know, you have the insight in real time and real experience as to what, you know, the realities behind the ability to bank this space actually are versus, you know, all of the misperceptions, misconceptions, and just, you know, general lack of knowledge that's out there, and as a consequence spreads, you know, inaccurate information. So that being said, right, and as you know, Michael, the first bank to publicly raise their hand and say we're going to bank the space and we're a legitimate FDIC insured bank was First Security Bank of Nevada. Mm-hmm. And the way in which that happened was in 2014, the Department of Treasury issued a memo, and at the end of the day, to skip through all of the finer details, the answer is that banks can bank the space. The Department of Treasury has given them clearance to do so. There are a list of requirements for them to do so, and those are costly for them to stay compliant. But they can bank the space. And so, you know, the comment of, you know, one of the biggest issues is, you know, our inability to have banking relationships. You know, I'd say one that's inaccurate because we have banking relationships all over the country. You know, I think that the question would be, you know, how much is it an impediment that we can't go to a major money center bank and have a global relationship with a Bank of America or Wells Fargo for a company like ours that's in multiple states and multiple countries? And the answer is it's a huge impediment. We have regional banking relationships. We have banking relationships on the West Coast. We have banking relationships in the Northeast. And, you know, we operate like any other business. It just happens to be an entire extra layer of stuff that we have to deal with on the accounting side and on the relationship side, because the major money center banks won't bank the space. And look, that's unfortunate. At the end of the day, there, you know, it's a reputational issue for the banks, as well as a cost issue, right? As big as marijuana is, if a major money center bank like Bank of America or Wells Fargo wanted to go bank this industry, you know, the reputational exposure they would have as they represent, you know, teachers' pensions funds, and they have money from the, you know, Catholic hospital chain in the U.S. or whatever it is, they might lose those accounts. And as big as our industry is, we pale in comparison to those dollars,
you
right?
Mean like so, HSBC yeah. laundering money for the cartels.
Yeah, I guess so. Well, you know, and just before you called, Adam, we were talking about Troy Dayton at ArcView, who was saying that he expects that the legal marijuana market in the country should grow from $6.9 billion last year to $21.6 billion by 2021 in just 4 years from now. And that's not new users. That's just a shifting of those revenues from the black market into a legitimate market. And just as you rang in, I was saying, you know, any other business that you have, if you could tell capitalists, investors, whoever, that you're going to triple the size of the market in 4 years, they would be jumping to get in. They would be begging you to accept their money to get into this. But you know, the problems that we're having in Washington D.C. Are still making a lot of these people nervous. And I do believe the market is going to grow. But I know you're going to have to go soon because you've got another meeting. But let me get your take on the new administration. I don't know whether you're left or right. You know, progressive, conservative, whatever, doesn't matter. But on this issue, what do you think that this new administration is going to do? And the reason I ask is because obviously people like Jeff Sessions and half a dozen of President Trump's cabinet appointees are prohibitionists. So how do you see the change? Because there's going to be some blowback from Washington, D.C., one way or the other. It always happens. So where do you see the industry going?
Well, sure. And before I move on, just because I think it's an important point on the banking side that Denver mm-hmm. gets mentioned is, you know, this is a $20 billion industry in 2021. Amazing. I am through the roof excited. I don't even have a voice left, as you can hear. Mm-hmm. At the end of the day, you know, CalSTRS, which is the teacher's pension fund in California, mm-hmm. is got $196 billion of AUM. So when you talk about the risk to these banks and you say, why aren't they so excited to go bank this industry, you know, there is a very easy, factual, you know, way to look at this. $200 billion from the teacher's pension in California, I don't know who banks them. If it's Bank of America, you know, if you're Bank of America, you're risking that to go have your 10 or 20% of the market in the marijuana space that you hope to be at $20 billion. So you want your, you know, so apples to apples economics, you know, that really is what's driving the lack of banking at the end of the day, in my opinion. So, but on to
that's a fascinating perspective, one that I haven't heard before, but it sounds very valid.
No doubt.
So the question was, how do I think the new
administration
impacts yeah. our industry? Well, look, this is how I look at it. You know, I'm not in this industry to go make an investment and sell out of that investment next year and go retire, right? Because that's a fallacy. That's not real world stuff. We started in this industry after you, and you know, I give you all the credit, Michael, for being a pioneer. But you know, we started in 2010. You know, 7 years ago. And I will be in this industry until I'm not in any industry anymore, or maybe my sons are old enough to come take us over and let me go take a nap. But you know, we're not creating our thesis around who's in the White House today or who the AG is today. You know, and I think that looking at it that way, you know, allows the prohibitionists to continue to make their points and continue to have those points heard. Because what other industry acts like that? Now, that's not saying that every industry doesn't try to exert influence, they don't try to lobby, they don't try to make sure to protect their own interests with dollars, and our political system is set up that way. But at the end of the day, people aren't saying, oh, I'm in the entertainment business because we got a great president in the White House.
Yeah.
And that's how we look at it. We don't look at anything in a vacuum. You know, I don't look at California legalizing adult use in a vacuum. I don't look at who's in the White House in a vacuum. What we're looking at is over 60% of the adult of the population in the U.S. lives in a state where marijuana is in some way, shape, or form legal, and that is trending. We're looking at, you know, our neighbor to the north is legalizing, you know, adult use at some point soon. More importantly, you have companies in Canada that are worth, on paper, publicly traded companies, over $1 billion. When you start in this industry, Michael, if I told you there would be a legitimate company licensed by a country that would have a public market cap in excess of $1 billion, and their CEO would literally be the CEO of a $1 billion company, and their business is marijuana, you probably would have fallen over.
No, I just would have asked to share some of what you're smoking.
So, you know, as much as there's been this, you know, this focus on the Jeff Sessions confirmation and Trump and what's he going to do, why? Why is that the focus? Because you're going to go react and leave this industry today because you don't like who's in the White House? Now, look, if you want to leave the country today because socially you have a problem with who's in the White House and you're worried about your kid's future, I can understand that. But if you're going to talk about it in regards to business and commerce, you know, there's a strong argument to be made that we have for the first time an opportunity to, you know, change our position within the tax code. Mm-hmm. Because this is the first time in almost two decades there's going to be huge tax reform. Right? I mean, there's a ton of arguments to be made that this is positive for our industry. There's a ton of arguments to be made that this is negative and leaves question marks for our industry. But the industry's not going away. Right? This is what it is to do business. And so I think that that's what's important to remember here when you're talking about the numbers and the growth and you're talking about the number of states and the number of people and the studies coming out on the medical side and the types of businesses and the types of people. You know, look, who's in the White House is in the White House. And if you don't like it, you should vote for somebody else next time. You know, we have more of an issue in our country with people not participating and then complaining after the fact.
Oh, absolutely.
At the end of the day, look, we're in this industry. You're not going anywhere.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm not going anywhere. And you talk about investors' fervor and all the rest of it. You know, the lack of investor fervor, when you say an industry growing that much, you would expect so many people to be so excited. But guys, this is a federally illegal business we're in.
No kidding.
So, you might know something about this. So throw the numbers out for a minute. I mean, it is a very special type of person that's willing to put money into something that's federally illegal.
Mm-hmm.
That's what's important here, not that Jeff Sessions might get confirmed as our new AG. And until that changes, you will still have that hesitancy. So, you know, I think we're on a continuum. I think the progress is great. I think assuming it's a done deal is a problem. And I think that we all have to continue to work even harder with the momentum that we have. But, you know, this industry's not going anywhere. You and I are not going anywhere. And, you know, this is just the evolution of you know, our industry as we work to end prohibition.
Well, let me ask you, because I know you've put a great deal of time, thought, and study into this. Do you think that there's talk about, if Hillary Clinton had been elected, she had been talking about rescheduling Schedule 2. Bernie Sanders had talked about descheduling entirely. President Trump has kind of been all over with this issue, but he has talked to some degree about a rescheduling. Do you think that, because you're talking about big money and the California Teachers Union, all this sort of stuff, do you think that if we go down to Schedule 2, that a lot of these cannabis entrepreneurs and this business is going to get gobbled up by big pharma or big alcohol or anything like that, because as large as we are, these markets are even larger. We had done a story just before you called about wine usage and in North America, and where wine usage is, retail sales are at $55.8 billion in America and another 3.2 in Canada. Pot is at $53.3 billion. So we're really catching up on that area. But do you see this or do you see these industries as exerting their large financial reserves to gobble up pieces of this, much as the oil industry started gobbling up solar companies in the 1970s and 80s to prevent them from getting an independent market share?
Yeah, great question to end with, because such an important question and so polarizing of a question and answer. And thank you, Michael, for putting me in a polarizing position to answer this one way or the other.
Well, you can just run out the clock.
Fine. You know, the same way that I look at, you know, who's in the White House and just say, what other business operates under the premise of I'm going to be in this industry or not based on who gets elected.
Mm-hmm.
You know, in the same manner, why would you expect anything other than common sense and logic to play out when it comes to what the future of the space looks like from a commercial perspective? I mean, commercially, your number is $52 billion, whatever the number is.
Mm-hmm.
Is that $52 billion industry going to be, you know, run and controlled by mom and pop operators?
Or is it going to be controlled by people who are paying south of the border? Yeah.
Right, but what $52 billion industry is? So when we're questioning, you know, what do we believe is going to happen? Is there going to be a roll-up? Are the big guys going to come in? And why are we at – because this is cannabis, you know, I think that we fall into the trap of looking at it through a lens, this special lens, because of our special personal attachment. But if we remove all the emotion – and look at this like any other business, any other $50 billion business, the answers are already there. We wouldn't even be having the discussion. Of course there's M&A. Of course there's institutionalization. But I'll leave you with this. Without institutionalization, there is no permanence, right? And for all the people, yourself included, that have, you know, put so much of who they are and their lives into ending prohibition, right? To end prohibition permanently, this industry must be institutionalized, because the only way to put it over the finish line and to keep it there, right? The you know, advocacy groups and the mom and pops and the people that have fought so hard, those people deserve all the credit in the world, right? But at a certain point, they need to go partner up with and or hand off parts of this task, you know, to the people that can permanently protect it. And look, whether we agree with it or not, again, stripping all the emotion, that is the only way you get permanence, right? And if you look at California as a great example, how did California legalize marijuana? First of all, why did it take 25 years to legalize marijuana in California? Why did California allow, you know, all the, what was it, were there two, four, whatever, three states legalized cannabis before California?
Mm-hmm.
Well, how did that happen when California was so at the forefront of this? The only time that it happened was once it became institutionalized, in the respect of it took our lieutenant governor, backed by Silicon Valley money and all the rest of the things that happened this time around, to get this thing done, right?
Yep.
And that's the permanence that I speak of. You know, look, legalization was on our ballot in California previously. Let's not forget that. And it failed.
Pioneers,
right?
Get slaughtered and settlers get the land, right?
Yeah, so I mean, look, I just think emotionally,
super,
you know, removed from it, your answer is already there. I think there's a ton of room for the mom and pops. I think that there's a lot of room for the small local players, but they're going to play within a system that at the end of the day will be controlled by bigger institutional players, and that's just inevitable.
Hmm. And let me ask you, just before you go, yeah, you know, you've done a tremendous amount of work, and truly, I respect what you are building, empire or otherwise, you know, with your business, multinational now. If people are more interested in MedMen, and we do have a lot of listeners and followers, and who knows where they are, how do they find out about your company online?
They go to a great place to start is our website, MedMen.com. So a lot of information there. And look, if nothing else, going there and getting to all the educational forums and blogs and commentary, you know, and just being part of the conversation, that's great. The more people that can be part of our conversation and help us shape our views, the better. So thanks for letting me plug.
Well,
that.
Great. And thank you for coming on. I mean, you know, obviously you're approaching this from a different perspective than a lot of the tie-dyed, hippies who've tried to push it so far. But the work is really important, and the success that you're having is, I think, absolutely legitimizing and proving what you've been doing. So, hey, thanks for being with us. We'll get back in touch with you in a few months, see how your facilities are going, and we appreciate that you two are fighting for this industry.
Thank you so much, guys, for having me. Have a great rest of your day. Always
you bet.
A pleasure, Michael.
Take
okay,
care.
Bye-bye.
Bye now. So before we go, what do you think of this? That it's going to be big, industrial concerns that are going to take this market over.
It's a predictable outcome for the mm-hmm. people who have put their time to build these small businesses to get swept under the rug by people mm-hmm. who had no interest in legalizing it and only really wanted to get into it when the money and the conditions were right. It always feels good to see the people who deserve it most get left behind.
Without naming names or situations, we recently met with owners of a facility, and one of these owners, who is absolutely anti-marijuana, got into this business and is acting like they're the bee's knees, like they're just their shit don't stink and. They know what they're doing, and they're
clueless. No offense, but they're not allowed to fail because the government has chosen the winners and losers in this state by the way of those special restrictive licensing. Mm-hmm. These people can be as dumb as they want. They're not allowed to fail. Mm-hmm. They're so optimally primed to take advantage of the new recreational market that they can be as dumb as they want and get away with it, which is what we're going to see, which makes me sick to my stomach. If they were allowed to fail mm-hmm. and free market capitalism was at play and we
as
were
in
able,
Colorado,
exactly, like we were able to do things like that, I would have no problem with allowing them to be as dumb as they wanted. But to see people have made such significant sacrifices, especially here in my hometown, mm-hmm. to see those people get passed over because certain people rub elbows with the right people or live in the correct neighborhood, it makes me sick.
Me
it makes
too.
Me absolutely sick.
Me too. So anyway, we're about out of time for today, and we hope you've enjoyed this discussion. Once again, we thank our guest, Adam Bierman of MedMen, for spending some time with us. We're going to get ready and be going up to legislature soon, so we'll keep you informed to all the latest news going on in Carson City. With that, we're going to sign off for this week. Perry, thanks so much again.
Absolutely. Thank you for having me.
Thank you for listening, and we'll see you next time.